Hello friends, I'm Dr. Ankur. Welcome to BLK Pediatric Practice. Today I will be talking about neonatal seizures in two parts. In the first part, we'll discuss about the etiopathogenesis. In the second part, I will discuss about the management. Neonatal seizure is defined clinically as a paroxysmal alteration in the neurological function, either in form of behavior, motor, and autonomic function. The majority of neonatal seizures in neonates are occasional, occurring as a reactive event to the acute insults, and significant percentage are the first symptoms of epilepsy. If you look at the prevalence in the term infants, it can be between 2 to 3 per 1,000 live births, whereas in preterm infants, it can be between 10 to 15 per 1,000 live births. Why seizure is important? It was found that it is not only the underlying condition which can lead to poor outcome, but it is the severity of seizure, duration of the seizure, which can lead to ultimately loss of cell loss of the brain, which can ultimately lead to poor outcome. Earlier the onset of the seizure, the chances would be poor outcome. So if you look at the neurodevelopmental impairment in term infants, in neonatal seizure can lead to 20 to 40% poor neurodevelopmental impairment as compared to preterm infants, where it can be up to 90%. Pathophysiology. Why neonates are prone to develop seizure? It's all because of the imbalance of inhibitory and excitatory neurotransmitter. Unfortunately, in newborn, the excitatory transmitter concentration is slightly higher as compared to inhibitory neurotransmitter. Not only that, the inhibitory transmitter, that is GABA, which acts as an excitatory transmitter in newborn, and at the time of insult, like in the cases of hypoxia, ischemia, the concentration of glutamate would also increase, and which can ultimately lead to excessive depolarizations and ultimately can lead to seizures. But why these imbalance happens? It was found that the excitation, the stimulation is important for brain development in neonates. More the concentrations of the excitatory transmitter, more would be the interconnections of the neuron and synapse formation, and ultimately lead to neuroplasticity. That is why it is also known as neurons that fires together, they wires together. Most neonatal seizures tend to remain focal, even if the damage is diffuse. The reason is that because the myelination is very poor, incomplete, there is a poor formation of the dendrites and synapses. That is why most of the seizure in the neonatal stage is either focal or multifocal. If you look at the clinical seizures type, there could be four types: subtle, tonic, myoclonic, and clonic. Out of all these, subtle seizures contributes up to 50%, and they can present as a ocular, orolingual, autonomic dysfunctions, or sometimes apnea. Though the name is subtle, but it's a misnomer, because it was found that most of the time in the cases of subtle seizure, the brain damage would be in the higher range as compared to the other clinical types of the seizures. If you look at the clinical correlations, it was found that the subtle seizures, clonic seizure, generalized myoclonic, focal tonic has a good EEG correlations as compared to focal myoclonic and generalized tonic seizure. If you look at the types of seizures in form of apnea, if apnea happens in a term infants, then it could be one of the type of seizure as compared to preterm infants. In the most of the time in preterm infants, it's because of immaturity and part of apnea of prematurity. That is why the American Neurological Society has defined that only electrographically documented seizures with or without clinical manifestations represents most accurate and current concepts of neonatal seizures. They have defined seizures in three parts. One is electroclinical, where the clinical symptoms would be present along with EEG finding. The second, only the clinical seizures where there would not be any EEG finding. And third, subclinical and occult seizure, where you may find EEG positive seizures, but there would not be any clinical findings, and it contributes up to 24% of the cases. However, in Indian scenario, we follow WHO guideline where we treat all the clinical seizures because of the scarcity of pediatric neurologists and availability of amplitude EEG, EEG or video EEG. If you look at the etiology of the seizures, most common reason for seizure in neonatal period is because of the secondary. Either it's because of insult, like in hypoxia, ischemia, encephalopathy, infections like meningitis, intracranial hemorrhage, metabolic, inborn error of metabolism. Hypoglycemia and hypocalcemia contributes only 6% of the causes of the seizure. And only rarely, this could be because of the primary epilepsy, either because of genetic regions. If you look at the timelines of the seizures, 33% of the seizures, they present during the first 24 hours of the life, and more than 60% of the seizure, they present during the first 7 days of the life. HIE would present during the first 48 hours of life. Metabolic can present during the first 3-4 days of the life. The hypoglycemia can present after, during first 24 hours or beyond 24 hours, like in the cases of hyperinsulinemic hypoglycemia state. Genetics, epilepsy causes can present at any time after birth. However, late onset hypocalcemia is common cause of seizure as compared to early onset hypocalcemia leading to the clinical seizures. If you look at the epileptogenesis, after initial insults, it takes weeks to months to develop chronic epilepsy, because during this time, sprouting, network organizations, neurogenesis, and gliosis happens, to ultimately leading to the brain damage, chronic brain damage, and causing epilepsy. That is why anti-epileptic drug we should not use in all cases of seizures after abortion of the seizures as a prophylaxis, because it's a misnomer, because no anti-epileptic drug can prevent any epilepsy. Thank you, friends.